Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 7th of May 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Thiruvananthapuram and Delhi editions. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of news articles taken up for today's discussion will be available in the description section and also in the comment section.
The first article of the day is the editorial which is titled Conservation Minus the People. This editorial stresses one issue, which is all the recent developments in India are proving the fact that India is openly moving away from community-involved conservation models in preserving India's biodiversity. This editorial appears in page number 8 in all the four editions taken up for today's discussion. The analysis of this editorial will be helpful in your mains preparation. In General Studies Paper 2 under Functions and Responsibilities of the Union and the States, Issues and Challenges Pertaining to the Federal Structure, Devolution of Powers and Finances up to Local Levels and Challenges therein. Next, under Government Policies and Interventions for Development in Various Sectors and Issues Arising out of their Design and Implementation, and in your General Studies Paper 3 under Conservation, Environmental Pollution and Degradation, Environmental Impact Assessment. The author tells that India does not recognize the value of community-involved conservation models. This is evident from the latest Supreme Court order. India is known for its biodiversity richness. The author tells that a decision of this nature has consequences for global natural heritage. Involving communities living in and around natural resource-rich areas in the management and use of these resources is an effective tool of conservation that has been recognized across the world. The author tells that it has been affirmed by some of the international conventions. There are some 5 conventions mentioned in the editorial. Some of the important ones are Earth Summit's 1992 Statement of Forest Principles and next the Convention on Biological Diversity. The author tells that India has been a vocal member of these conventions, but in India things operate rather differently. The author then discusses about the legislations and government policies that are in place to conserve the biodiversity and how these legislations and policies are driving away the local communities from conservation by various means. Let us now see the timelines of these legislations and policies and their effects. The author notes that India's conservation legislation is separated into those that protect forests and its produce and those that target wildlife conservation. For forests, we have the Indian Forest Act of 1927, and for wildlife conservation, we have the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. Both these acts create different types and grades of protected areas and contain provisions to restrict or outlaw local use of natural resources and landscapes, if you see. From the 1980s, there were a number of policies that mirrored the global shift towards inclusive conservation, such as the 1988 National Forest Policy, the 1992 National Conservation Strategy, the National Environmental Policy of the year 2006, and the 2007 Biosphere Reserves Guidelines. While these people-friendly policy statements made their way into India's conservation lists, its earlier exclusionary conservation legislation, which are nothing but the Indian Forest Act of 1927 and Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, continued to stay in place. These legislations overpowered the inclusive conservation. The author notes that in an attempt to bridge this divide, the 1990 Joint Forest Management Guidelines was introduced by the government. These guidelines created community institutions for co-management in collaboration with the forest bureaucracy. Although it initially registered some success stories in certain parts of the country, the joint forest management committees are widely critiqued as being bureaucracy heavy, which means the involvement of bureaucracy in day-to-day matters, with little real devolution of powers to the local communities. The author then tells that a dramatic shift in the Indian conservation paradigm came in the year 2006 through the Forest Rights Act. This act went beyond sanctioning local usage to conferring rights to local communities over forest land and their produce. The Ministry of Tribal Affairs was mandated with operationalizing this particular Forest Rights Act of 2006, while the conservation remained under the domain of the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. The author also notes that in reality, the forest bureaucracy is having an upper hand and that this forest bureaucracy is against the inclusive conservation. The uncertainty regarding India's stand on inclusive conservation can be observed since the past 3 years. all the policies wish to do away with community involvement in the conservation of biodiversity, which is nothing but the inclusive conservation. Some of the recent developments mentioned by the author that substantiates her claims of India moving away from the community involved conservation approach are mentioned here. Firstly, we have the third National Wildlife Action Plan. It was introduced in the year 2017 with the stated intent of complying with international commitments. But this action plan highlights that the locals hinder the conservation. Where communities are to be involved, this action plan stresses on conservation within a bureaucracy control format. Next, the author has mentioned the 2018 draft National Forest Policy. This policy has emphasized the protected area model of conservation. This model leaves little room for communities to involve in conservation activities. Next, the author mentions the recent Supreme Court's order in the early 2019. The Supreme Court ordered to evict those forest dwellers whose claims under the Forest Rights Act of 2006 have been rejected. The Supreme Court here did not consider the bureaucratic violations or lapses or any technical constraints in validating these claims. All these factors have led to a huge amount of rejections. Now the order has been temporarily stayed by the court. Next, in March 2019, a comprehensive amendment to the Indian Forest Act of 1927 was proposed. This amendment introduces provisions for removing the rights granted under the Forest Rights Act of 2006. Further, it grants the forest bureaucracy unprecedented powers like to enter and search the premises of forest dwellers on suspicion, arrest them without warrant, and use firearms to meet the conservation goals. The author tells that the state authority that is usually reserved to tackle terrorism, insurgency, and organized crime is now being deployed to safeguard biodiversity. Finally, the author tells that there is a proposal to the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972 as well. Thus, the author concludes that India's conservation policies in recent years does not recognize the value of community-involved conservation models. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this particular editorial. Now, have a look at the practice mains question. We shall discuss at the end of the analysis session. The second news article of the day titled DISCOM Dept to Return to Pre-UDAY Levels. This news explains in detail about the issues plaguing the state DISCOM companies. This news article appears in your business column in page 13 in all the four editions. The contents analyzed in this news article will be helpful in your prelims under economic development and in your mains preparation in general studies paper 2 under government policies and interventions for development in various sectors and issues arising out of their design and implementation, and in general studies paper 3 under Indian economy, and next under infrastructure, energy in particular. The news is that the aggregate external debt of the state-owned electricity distribution companies, in short called DISCOMs, is set to increase to the pre-Ujjwal DISCOM Assurance Yojana levels of Rs 2.6 lakh crore by the end of this fiscal. This value is based according to CRISIL's analysis of DISCOMs in 15 states. The DISCOMs in these 15 states account for 85% of the aggregate losses. In this newspaper, you can see some of the terms like end of this fiscal and fiscal 2020 and also fiscal 2019. All these are one and the same. A fiscal year is denoted by the year in which it ends. So, for Indian scenario, if the fiscal year starts on 1st of April 2019 and ends on 31st of March 2020, then it is termed as fiscal 2020. In this context of this news article, let us now know in brief about the UDAY policy of the Government of India. UDAY is the acronym for Ujjwal DISCOM Assurance Yojana. DISCOM refers to power distribution companies. This scheme was launched in the year 2015 in the month of November. The scheme is administered by the Ministry of Power. The aim of UDAY is to provide affordable and accessible 24/7 power to all. The main objectives of UDAY scheme is to improve the state-owned power generation and distribution companies by focusing on their financial turnaround, operational improvement, reduction of cost of generation of power, development of renewable energy, and also focus on the energy efficiency and conservation. Out of these five objectives, the first two objectives have been discussed in this news article. First, let us see with respect to the operational improvement. Based on the memorandum of understanding signed between the DISCOMs and the respective state governments, the operational improvements have been made possible by means of structural reforms. These structural reforms have to be initiated by the DISCOMs as per the UDAY scheme. Few targets have been mentioned under this particular UDAY scheme under operational improvement. The first one is to reduce the aggregate technical and commercial losses, in short AT and C losses, by 900 basis points from the pre-UDAY levels. So a 15% reduction should be achieved by fiscal 2019. But the reality is that these AT and C losses have reduced only 400 basis points as of December 2018. Now, the second target was to implement regular tariff hikes for power at the range of 5 to 6% per annum. But currently, the average tariff increase, if you see, is at 3% per annum only. Thus, Chrysler notes that the DISCOM should start focusing on the structural reforms as soon as possible. Coming to the second objective of UDAY scheme, which is the financial turnaround. This refers to improving the financial turnaround of the state DISCOM companies that are burdened with huge debts. Under UDAY scheme, it has been agreed that the respective state governments will finance 3/4 of the DISCOM's debt. Chrysler has observed that with most states having limited budget, continuous financial support to their DISCOMs may be difficult. So Chrysler tells that DISCOMs have to become commercially viable through prudent tariff hikes year on year and a material reduction in aggregate technical and commercial, nothing but the AT and C losses. The senior director of Chrysler Ratings has noted that further improvement in operations may face challenges because a focus on new rural connections without adequate tariff hikes can increase losses of the state DISCOMs. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Have a look at the practice prelims question. We shall discuss at the end of the analysis session. The third news article of the day is over 100 US firms to join Department of Commerce on trade visit to India. This article appears in the business column in page number 13 in all the four editions taken up for today's analysis. This news article will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national and international importance and in your mains preparation in General Studies Paper 2 under bilateral, regional groupings and agreements involving India and affecting India's interests, and also under effect of policies and politics of developed countries on India's interests. This particular news article is in news because the Trade Winds Business Forum is being held in New Delhi from May 6 to 8 with an aim to discover business opportunities for the US companies in the Indo-Pacific region. The Trade Wind Business Program is the largest US government-led trade mission. The 11th annual mission of this program is being conducted this year in India with a focus on Indo-Pacific region. The Trade Winds program has two main components, if you see. The first one is the business forum and the next one is the trade mission stops event. The business forum is the main conference of Trade Winds and the trade mission stops, which are nothing but multiple business related discussions. All these will be held in Delhi and six other cities in India and also in Sri Lanka and Bangladesh this year. The forum will have the speeches of the business leaders and the government leaders, then panel discussion with key experts in commerce and economic diplomats. Networking events will also be conducted to network the region's leading industry and government officials with the experienced US and global companies. Also, there will be one-to-one counseling with commercial experts. The news article states that the goal of the US Department of Commerce is to ensure fair and reciprocal trade for US businesses to sell their products and services all over the world. Note that all these developments are happening in the backdrop of end of the minimum notice period of 60 days given by the United States government to India, which is regarding the withdrawal of benefits of Generalized System of Preferences program, in short GSP program. Note that India also has recently extended the deadline to impose high import duties on 29 US products to May 16, 2019. India is extending the dates as both India and US are negotiating a trade package in order to boost the bilateral trade and commerce. In this context, let us now know about some few facts related to the bilateral trade between India and the United States. India-US bilateral trade in goods and services increased from $104 billion from the year 2014 to $114 billion in the year 2016. For the year 2018, this particular India-US bilateral trade stands at $142.1 billion, where the Indian exports to US stands at $83.2 billion and imports to India from US stands at $58.9 billion. This means India is having a trade surplus to the tune of $24.3 billion with the United States. Trade surplus is seen in both merchandise trade, that is in goods to the tune of $21.3 billion, and also in services to the tune of $3 billion. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. The fourth news article of the day is about the endangered species, especially the grizzled giant squirrel. This article titled Nests of Grizzled Giant Squirrel Spotted in Tamil Nadu has appeared on page 7 in Delhi edition only. The discussion under this article is relevant in the preliminary preparation under general issues on biodiversity. The nests of grizzled giant squirrels, which is an endangered species, have been spotted for the first time by the researchers. More than 300 nests were spotted in the Pakkamalai Reserve Forest and also in the Anantapuram Reserve as well. And majority of the nests were found in the Pakkamalai Reserve Forest, which is located in the Vilupuram district of Tamil Nadu. Hence, the researchers have requested the government to immediately declare these forests as a sanctuary for the grizzled giant squirrel. The Anantapuram Reserve is located in the state of Karnataka. Several diverse and endangered species, including the Indian golden gecko, bamboo pit viper, and mouse deer, have also been spotted in the Pakkamalai Reserve Forest. Now, let us know about these endangered species in the prelims perspective. Grizzled giant squirrel is also known as the Sri Lankan giant squirrel. It is an endemic giant squirrel distributed in southern India and in the country of Sri Lanka. The distribution range in India spans the area between Grizzled Squirrel Wildlife Sanctuary in the south and Hosur Forest Division in the north. Within this range, the grizzled giant squirrel is confined to low elevation riparian forest and low precipitation zones of the western and the eastern ghats. The largest populations in southern India are recorded from Chinnar Wildlife Sanctuary and Grizzled Squirrel Wildlife Sanctuary. Besides these, scattered populations are also found in various forest patches such as Theni Forest Division, Anamalai Tiger Reserve, Palani Hills, Sirumalai Hills, Kaveri Wildlife Sanctuary. This species is restricted mostly to patchy riverine habitats in the rain shadow areas of southern India, and it feeds primarily on seeds of immature and mature fruits from the trees and climbers. Due to its restricted distribution, small population size and anthropogenic pressure to its natural habitats, this particular species is classified under the near threatened category of the International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources Red List of Threatened Species, that is in short the IUCN Red List. And the species is also listed in Schedule 1, Part 1 of the Indian Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. And then the grizzled giant squirrel is also listed under Schedule 2 of the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora, that is nothing but the CITES. Next, let us see about Indian golden gecko. Its scientific name is Calodactylodes aureus. The etymology of its genus name Calodactylus comes from a Latin word meaning for beautiful fingers. This is because of the unique triangular lamellae on their feet, which makes them very adept at sticking to vertical surfaces. This strikingly colored yellowish or dark brown color lizard is endemic to the eastern ghats of India. The species was virtually unknown for a long time till its discovery in the year 1985. This particular species inhabits rocky crevices, rock boulders, and it prefers rocky area with deep stream valleys and highly elevated rocky hills. Indian golden gecko is found in southern Andhra Pradesh from Seshachalam and Vellikonda ranges, and in Vellore region of northern Atkad district of Tamil Nadu, Castle Rock of Karnataka, and Nyamgiri Hills of Kalahandi and Raigada districts of Odisha. This gecko has been listed as least concern in the IUCN Red List. Indian golden gecko also holds the distinction of being the only gecko to be categorized in Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, but it finds no mention in the CITES list. Next, let us see about bamboo pit viper. It is also known as Indian tree viper or green tree viper. This arboreal and nocturnal bamboo viper is very aggressive in nature and an amazing green tree snake found in India. This species is known from the peninsular region and is recorded in the western ghats from Dangs of Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa,
Karnataka, Kerala, and Tamil Nadu. And also in the Eastern Ghats, that includes Shevarai, Javadi Hills, Seshachalam Hills, and Nalamala Hills. This species has also been reported from the Kaval Wildlife Sanctuary in Andhra Pradesh. It has also been recorded from Achanakma Tiger Reserve in the state of Chhattisgarh. It has also been recorded from Odisha as the northernmost record. Historically, this species has also been reported from Madhya Pradesh. This species has been listed as least concern in the IUCN Red List, but it finds no mention in the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972 and also in the sites list. Next, let us see about mouse deer, which is also known as Indian chevrotains. It is found in India and in the country of Sri Lanka. Mouse deer in general occupy a range of habitats from evergreen forests to plantations. Other than being preyed upon by carnivores like dholes, tigers and leopards, Indian chevrotain plays an important ecological role as seed dispersers. The main threat for this particular species is from hunting by the local communities, and this local hunting of the species is either sportive or for wild meat. And then another threat is the forest fire, as they are sensitive to habitat loss, alteration and degradation. This particular species is listed as least concern by the IUCN Red List, and it is also categorized in Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, but it finds no mention in the sites list. Now have a look at the practice prelims question, which I'll discuss at the end of the session. The fifth news article of the day is 1 million species at risk of extinction, United Nations. This news article appears on page number 12 in all the four editions taken up for today's discussion. This article is relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of international importance and under general issues on environmental ecology and biodiversity, and also in your mains preparation in general studies paper 3 under conservation, environmental pollution and degradation. The article is in news as recently the summary for policymakers of the Global Assessment Report on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services was published by Intergovernmental Science Policy Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services. The report being compiled is called as Global Assessment Report, which is compiled by IPBES. The report was prepared at the request of Conference of Parties of the UN Convention on Biodiversity. The sixth chapter full report is not yet released, which will be done later this year. This organization is an independent intergovernmental body established by more than 100 countries in the year 2012. The objective of this organization is to strengthen the science policy interface, that is, to strengthen the interface between science and policy makers for biodiversity and ecosystem services. This is done for the purpose of the conservation and sustainable use of biodiversity, long-term human well-being and sustainable development. The interface is strengthened by providing reliable, independent and credible information on status of biodiversity. Note that India is also a member in this platform. This is a fully intergovernmental body, which means only governments of countries can be full-fledged members. Any entities other than governments can only be observers. This platform's secretariat is located in Bonn in Germany. The summary describes the direct drivers of change in nature with largest global impact. The land use change and the sea use change have had the largest relative negative impact on nature since 1970, followed by the direct exploitation or over-exploitation of animals, plants and other organisms. This is followed by climate change, then pollution and then invasion of alien species. Agricultural expansion is the most widespread form of land use change. The expansion of agriculture inland, with a doubling of urban area since the year 1992 and an unprecedented expansion of infrastructure linked to growing population and consumption, has come mostly at the expense of forests, wetlands and the grasslands. Unsustainable over-exploitation of fish, shellfish and other organisms is a factor under sea use change and also exploitation of organisms. Coming to climate change, humans have caused a global warming of approximately 1 degree Celsius by the year 2017 compared to pre-industrial levels, and this has resulted in increased frequency and intensity of extreme weather events. With respect to pollution, greenhouse gas emissions, untreated urban and rural waste, pollutants from industrial, mining and agricultural activities, oil spills and toxic dumping have had strong negative effects on soil, fresh water and marine water quality and the global atmosphere as well. About invasion of alien species, nearly one-fifth of the Earth's surface is at risk of plant and animal invasions that is severely impacting native species and ecosystem functions and also impacting nature's contributions to the human beings. The news article highlights the key findings of this report. Most important among all is that many of around 10 lakh species on Earth are at risk of extinction within some decades. Around 40% of this are to be amphibian species and 33% reforming coral animals will become extinct within some decades, and then 33% marine animals and 10% insect species. Insect species are important for pollinating food crops. More than 5 lakh terrestrial plant and animal species are with insufficient habitat for long-term survival and habitat restoration is not happening. 25% of man-made emissions, particularly greenhouse gas emissions, is caused by land clearing, crop production and fertilization, with animal-based food or meat contributing to 75% of these emissions was found. Only 7% of marine fish stocks are harvested at sustainable levels or below sustainable levels. This means 93% of the fish stocks are unsustainably harvested or caught. Also, 75% of land is under severe impact of degradation due to human activity or anthropogenic activity, and a tenfold increase in plastic production is seen since 1990. All these adds up pollution to unsustainable levels. With respect to climate, with the present way of life across the world or in the present trend, Earth is to warm by 4.3 degrees Celsius more by 2100, which will lead to wiping out of 17% of the species. This report is of huge significance and we'll be having more news articles about this in the days to come. Now, have a look at practice prelims question, which will be discussed at the end of the analysis session. The sixth and the final news article of the day is about National Green Tribunal seeking a report on an alleged illegal road construction in Rajaji Tiger Reserve. This article appears on page 2 in Delhi edition only. This news article is relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national importance, next under general issues on environmental ecology and biodiversity, and in your mains preparation in general studies paper 2 under functioning of the executive, and next in your general studies paper 3 under environmental conservation. Moving on to the analysis, a petition was filed before National Green Tribunal about an alleged illegal road construction in the Laldang Chillarkal buffer area of Rajaji Tiger Reserve. Note that the National Green Tribunal is a statutory body established as per the provisions of National Green Tribunal Act of 2010. It was stated that even after getting the closure order for the Laldang Chillarkal road from the district forest officer, the state government has gone for the construction of the road. The article states that the road was open for commercial use in the month of March 2017. The petitioner tells that the road construction has a severe negative effect on the in situ and ex situ conservation that are in progress in the Tiger Reserve, and that the construction will potentially damage the biodiversity and resources of the Tiger Reserve. On hearing the petition, the National Green Tribunal has formed a panel of representatives to look into the matter and to give report about the illegal construction of the road within 3 months. Regarding the compliance of submission of the report, the National Tiger Conservation Authority is to be the nodal agency. In this context, first let us know about the Rajaji Tiger Reserve. Rajaji Tiger Reserve is located in the state of Uttarakhand. The area of Rajaji Tiger Reserve was notified as a Tiger Reserve in the year 2015 by the state government of Uttarakhand after the recommendation of the National Tiger Conservation Authority. This is in accordance with Section 38V of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. In the year 1983, there were 3 wildlife sanctuaries in this particular area, that is the Rajaji Wildlife Sanctuary, Motichur Wildlife Sanctuary and Chilla Wildlife Sanctuary. These 3 sanctuaries were merged in the year 1983 and was declared as Rajaji National Park. Note that the core area of Rajaji Tiger Reserve covers the entire area of Rajaji National Park, and it has a buffer zone to the east of the national park to the tune of 255 square kilometers. Coming to the in situ and ex situ conservation. In situ means on site, or for your understanding, it refers to the conservation of species in its natural habitat. Ex situ conservation means off-site conservation or conservation of species in a man-made habitat that imitates a natural habitat. Example for in situ conservation in Indian context will be your national parks, biosphere reserves and wildlife sanctuary, whereas the example for ex situ conservation would be the zoological gardens, in short the zoos. The displayed prelims practice question will be discussed in the final session. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion.
Question 1. Consider the following statements. Ujjwal Discom Assurance Yojana provides for the financial turnaround and revival of the state power distribution companies in India. And statement 2 is, the scheme is administered by the Ministry of Power. Here both the statements are correct. Both are direct statements. Note that UDAY scheme was introduced in November 2015. The question is asked for the correct answer. So the correct answer here is option C, both 1 and 2, since both the statements are correct. Moving on to the next question. With reference to the grizzled giant squirrels, which of the following statements is or correct? The first statement, it is an endemic giant squirrel distributed in southern India and Sri Lanka. It is a correct statement. And statement 2, it is given protection under Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. This statement is also correct. Statement 3, it is classified as endangered in the IUCN Red List. This statement is wrong. The grizzled giant squirrels are classified under the near threatened category in IUCN Red List. And in statement 4, it is listed under Schedule 2 of the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora. Here the fourth statement is correct. It is listed under the CITES. So the question is asked for the correct answer. The correct answer here is option B, 1, 2 and 4, since statement 3 is wrong. Moving on to the third question, which of the following species is or protected by the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972? First, gharial, second, golden gecko, third, bamboo pit viper, fourth, wild buffalo, fifth, mouse deer. Now, try to go by the elimination technique. Here, 1 and 2 appear in all the options, so we need to find out if the remaining 3 are protected under the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. We saw that mouse deer is protected under Wildlife Protection Act of 1972 during our discussion, and the bamboo pit viper is not classified or protected under the Wildlife Protection Act. So the question here has asked for the correct answer. The correct answer here is option C, 1, 2, 4 and 5, 1B. Moving on to the fourth prelims question. Consider the following statements with reference to Intergovernmental Science Policy Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services. The statement 1 is, the objective of IPBES is to strengthen the science policy interface for biodiversity and ecosystem services for the conservation and sustainable use of biodiversity, long-term human well-being and sustainable development. This statement is correct. And the second statement is, IPBES is a fully intergovernmental body. The second statement is also correct here. It is a fully intergovernmental body. Many NGOs, organizations, conventions and civil society groupings also participate in the formal IPBES process only as observers. Only governments of recognized countries can be members in IPBES. So here the question is asked for the correct answer. The correct answer to this question is option C, 1 and 2, since both the statements are correct. Moving on to the final and the fifth prelims question. Consider the following statements. The statement 1 is, the National Tiger Conservation Authority notifies an area as tiger reserve after receiving the recommendation from the appropriate state government. Here the first statement is incorrect, as it is done in accordance with section 38V of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. So according to this provision, a state government shall, on the recommendations of the Tiger Conservation Authority, notify an area of the tiger reserve. It is not the otherwise. Statement 2 is, the Rajaji Tiger Reserve is located in the state of Tamil Nadu. Here the second statement is wrong, because the Rajaji Tiger Reserve is in the state of Uttarakhand. 4 tiger reserves are there in the state of Tamil Nadu. They are Kalakad Mundandurai Tiger Reserve, Mudumalai Tiger Reserve, Satyamangalam Tiger Reserve and Anamalai Tiger Reserve. So here the question is asked for the correct answer. The correct answer here is option D, neither 1 nor 2, since both the statements are wrong. Moving on to the practice mains question. The question is, involvement of local communities is very crucial for the conservation of natural resources. However, the recent developments in India seem to move away from the community-involved conservation approach. Discuss. So here the first part of the question is a factual statement. Mention the importance of local communities and then mention some of the international conventions that stresses this fact. For the second part of the question, which asks about recent developments, you can mention the points discussed under recent developments and tell that they indicate India's moving away from the community-involved conservation approach. With this, we come to the end of today's analysis and also the practice question discussion session. Please do like, comment and share the video, and please do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.